Hi everyone, in this video, I will explain about the analysis and design of returning structure for the gravity returning wall. So the learning outcome from this topic is to analyze the external stability of gravity returning wall due to the overturning, sliding, and also the bearing capacity. The gravity returning walls depends essentially upon their own weight for external stability. And this limit state should be examined. For the overturning, that it recommended to have the FOS at least 2. And for the sliding, the recommended factor of safety, also 2. And for the bearing pressure under the base, should be minimum 3. And the occurrence of the tension in lateral joints and the overall slip failure of the returning wall. So this is the some typical minimum factor of safety that referring to the slope engineering design. Okay, from the JKR Malaysia, you can see that if you have the rigid returning structure. For example, here that the minimum FOS for the overturning is 2, sliding is 1.5, overall stability 1.5, and also the bearing capacity is 2.0. This is the minimum factor of safety. Okay. Alright, so we start with the overturning. Alright, so usually we will assume that the center of the movement is about the toe here. Alright, so you will have this earth field or the back field behind the returning wall. So you will have the slab, which is on the right side here is a heel slab, and this is at the toe slab. And so you will have the stem. So for the overturning moment, this is the equation that we use to get the factor of safety. So the stabilizing moment over the overturning moment. Yeah? So you can see here that the weight from the returning wall here will resist from the movement of the wall, will resist from the overturning. However, that the passive, the lateral active pressure will cause the wall to overturn. Okay, and the weight of the wall will resist from the overturning. Okay, for example here, we want to check the stability of the returning wall. Given the soil is silty gravel sand with the horizontal surface and there is no surcharge here, and also the water table lies well below the base, means that the water table far below from this base of the foundation. And given the properties of the soil is here, and also the unit weight of the concrete, so this is the concrete, this one also the concrete part. Okay, so with all the dimension given, so we need to analyze the factor of safety to check the stability. Okay, so let's start with the stabilizing moment. Okay, as mentioned earlier, that the weight of the wall will resist from the wall to overturn. So that's why, so we will have this kind of the data, this kind of the table to analyze the stability of the wall. So let's start with the W1 here. W1 here is at the stem of the returning structure. Okay, you have the weight, unit weight of the concrete here is 24, and then you calculate the area for the W1 here. Okay, so that's why you have this width 0.3 meter, and the height of the wall is taken here 7.25. All right, so you will have this value. And then we need to calculate the force, which is unit weight times with the area. So you have the unit weight and the area, so you can straightforward get the force. And then the lever arm, the actions of the moment. Alright, so it's actually the length, alright, from the center of the structure to the toe here. Alright, so how you can get 1.85 is actually from the, so here is 1.7 plus with the 0.3. So we want the distance x1 here. Okay, from the center of the W1 to the point of overturn here. Okay, then you simply times the force with the lever arm here, you can get the moment from W1. Okay, same goes to the process with W2. Okay, here at the slab here, right, you have concrete slab here with the unit weight is 24, and then it's about the size here, the area, so you have 5.2 for the width and 0.75 for the height. Okay, and then you can get the force and the lever arm. Okay, again you check at the middle, it is from the center of W2, which is you need the X2 here. Okay, since you know that the length of this base is 5.2, you just divide by 2, you will get the 2.6 here. Then calculate the moment. And don't forget, okay, we also consider the weight of this backfill. Okay, this is the soil backfill behind the wall with these properties. So unit weight given is 20 kN per meter cube for the unit weight of soil. Okay, and then we will consider the size of the W3. Okay, so you have the 3.2 for the width, and also the height or the thickness is 7.25 meter. Okay, and then you calculate the force, and don't forget the lever arm here is 3.6. How they get the 3.6? Okay, so from this 3.2, you take it from the center, so it will be 3.2 divided by 2, and then you have the 0.3 here and plus 1.7, because it should refer to this point of overturn here. Okay, from the center of the W3, okay, to the distance, horizontal distance to point of overturn, which is X3 here. Alright, so you get 3.6, and then you calculate the moment. And then sum up the moment. Okay, you total the moment here. Okay. However, if you have the surcharge effect, means that you have the surcharge above here, so you need to consider the surcharge. So it would be the W4. Okay, if you have this surcharge. Alright, so you will have the Q value is in kilonewton per meter square. Okay, and then you have this size. Alright, it's not the area, but then the length of the surcharge here, A. And then you can need to calculate the force, which is Q times with the A. Okay, and then still you have to get the lever arm, which is 3.6. Exactly similar with the W3 just now. Okay, and then don't forget to get the moment. Okay, from the force here, you times with the lever arm. And also, if there is a passive lateral earth pressure, or PP, from the front fill here, also need to consider. Okay, the forces and the moment. Alright, so how to get this passive pressure is exactly like what we do in the lateral of pressure calculation. Okay, right, you need to have the KP, coefficients of the passive pressure. You need to calculate the horizontal stress, this equation, get the force, which is from the area of the diagram. For example, here is the triangular shape, so the area of the diagram is based on the triangular. Okay, and also the lever arm, which is exactly what we have from the lateral pressure, that it will be the H over 3 for the part of passive pressure here. Okay, so this one will become the H. And then calculate the moment by using again F times with the X, the force times with the level arm here. So since this is the force, which is the area, means that you will have half times with gamma H times with the H. Okay, for the passive pressure. Okay. So now, that's for the stabilizing moment. So now we check what the pressure that will cause the overturning, that will make the retaining wall to overturn. Alright, so it's obviously from the active pressure. Okay, it's obviously from the active pressure. So from this exercise, we only have the effect of the soil itself from the backfill. So you will have this distribution diagram of active pressure. So as usual, you calculate the active pressure coefficient, this delta, the sigma horizontal here, and then the force, which is the area of the diagram, okay, and also the level arm, yeah, this one is also H over 3 because we have the triangular shape of the diagram. So the H will take along this H, okay, and you can get the moment, which is F times with the X. So if you have again, yeah, if you have the effect of surcharge, so you also need to consider the effect of the surcharge, means that you will have another shape for the pressure distribution for the surcharge. Okay, you need to consider all the load factors. Alright, so then if you have the total from the lateral of pressure that will have tendency to overturn the retaining wall, okay, you can use this equation, which is the total of stabilizing moment, okay, divided by with the total of overturning moment. Right, so you will have the value, so you can check whether it's fulfill the requirement that we need. Okay, for example, here requirement is 2. So if you get more than 2, means that the stability is adequate and this wall is safe for the factor of overturning. Okay, alright. And then for the sliding, alright, for the sliding, so this is the equation, alright. So if the overturning, we consider, we concern about the moment, but for the sliding, we concern about the forces. Alright, so the summations of horizontal resistance force will divide by the forces that causing the sliding effect. Alright, so this is the equation. Alright, V is the force tangent to the friction between concrete and soil. And 0.5 PP here is a passive pressure, lateral pressure. And PA here is the active lateral pressure. Alright, so this is the outline of the sliding movement. Alright, so the forces will resist from sliding. And also the passive pressure will resist the wall from sliding. But the active pressure are the forces that will cause the wall to sliding. Okay. Alright, so referring to the same example. Alright, so if you notice that we still use the same table of the data just now, but then we only focus on the part of the force. Okay, so we still have a structure of the retaining wall here. Just now we are using W1, but now it will be V1. Yeah, vertical forces V1 from the stem of the retaining wall, and then from the slab here, and also from the backfill. And if you have the surcharge, again you need to consider the surcharge also. Alright, and also if you have the passive pressure, you need to consider the basic pressure. Okay, if you have the front field, so you also need to consider the basic pressure. Okay, using the same table just now, but only take the part for the force here. Alright, so you total the force here, and then you determine the friction. Delta here is angle of friction divided by 2. Okay, and then also from the force causes to sliding, from the force causes to sliding, which is from the active pressure. Okay, from the active pressure. Again, you also focus on the force part. Okay, if you notice that in previous table, we have the lever arm here and moment. Okay, but now we are focused, our concern is on the force here. Right, so just take the data from the force column here. Again, if you have the surcharge, okay, you need to consider the active pressure due to the surcharge. Okay, if you have all the information, we already have the V. Okay, tangent 20 is the tangent delta here. So, since in this exercise, there is no passive pressure, so we only have this equation, this value for this exercise. But if you have the front field, you need to consider the passive pressure and divide by the force from the active pressure. Okay. And then again, you check whether it's fulfilled the requirement. If not, means that it is inadequate or unsafe. Okay. So what we can do if you get this value of FOS sliding means that it's less than the requirement. Okay, you can use a base key here. Okay, use base key to increase the passive resistance. Okay. Alright. So, means that by having the key here, alright, the calculations of the passive pressure will consider until the base of key here. Alright. And then also you can increase the width of the base slab here. Okay. Then, you need to redesign by using the new base slab, the width of the base slab, or by having the base of the key, redesign, recalculate, check whether the FOS is fulfilled the requirement or not. And the last part is for the bearing capacity. Okay, so the retaining wall at the base should be designed to satisfy the ultimate state in terms of bearing. Right, so distributions of the ground bearing pressure can be trapezoidal and also can be triangle. Alright, so the value of the bearing pressure, the value of the bearing pressure must not exceed the allowable bearing capacity of the soil. Okay, so how it works actually. So, for example here. Okay, we need to check at the base, pressure at the base here. Okay, so now we determine the position of X. Okay, so by having this equation, the moment stability divide minus to the moment of overturning and divide by the total vertical forces. Alright, so this value are taken from the previous calculation, from the overturning and also from the sliding. So we determine the eccentricity. Alright, eccentricity means that the positions of the load, the positions of the column load, is slightly away from the center line. Okay. So, we determine the eccentricity, which is E, that can be obtained from this equation. B over 2 minus width X. B is the size of the base, width of the base just now, which is 5.2. Okay, divide by 2 and minus with this x. So you can get it's negative 0.08. Okay, then we need to check whether the pressure distribution is in the shape of trapezoidal or triangular. Okay, if you have that E, eccentricity is less than B over 6, so the distribution would be like this. Okay, so we check first with B over 6. So B over 6 is 0.87. We have the E is negative 0.08, means that E is less than 0.87. Alright, so we will have this kind of distribution. So we will analyze the base maximum pressure based on this distribution. Okay, so now we need to check the ground bearing pressure at A and B. What is an A and B? A at the toe, B at the heel here. Alright, so from this distribution, the maximum base pressure will be at point A here. And this is will become the Q minimum. So our concern is the maximum pressure. Alright, so we can calculate the Q maximum is by using this equation. V over B plus 6V vertical forces E eccentricity over width of the base power of 2. And QB here is the Q minimum. So we need to calculate Q max. And this Q max need to be compared with the maximum bearing capacity. Okay. So we already have all the information from the previous steps. So this is the V vertical forces here is 609.8 here. And then over B, B is 5.2. So this is 6 times with the vertical forces here. And then times with the E eccentricity and B power of 2. So you will get the maximum base pressure. Maximum base pressure is 128.1. Okay, if you have the E more than B over 6, if you have E more than B over 6, so the pressure distribution will become like this. Okay, it will be triangular. Means that here will become the Q max at the toe and Q min is here at point C. Alright, so if you get this E over B over 6, you will use this equation to get the Q max. Okay, maximum base pressure is by using this equation. If you have E more than B over 6. Okay. Alright, so now we can calculate the FOS against bearing capacity by using this equation. Q ultimate or the Q allowable bearing capacity over the Q maximum ground bearing pressure. So this Q max that what we have just now. Okay, the Q max is the maximum ground bearing pressure at point A here just now. Okay, if the you can get the ultimate bearing capacity, Q ultimate, okay, by using the equation that used to establish the allowable bearing capacity for the foundation. Okay, if you can still remember, okay, that we have this equation, yeah, for the foundation. QF is equivalent to CNC plus sigma and Q plus half B gamma and gamma. Okay, so by referring to this bearing capacity factor. Alright, so ignoring the depth of embedments. Okay, means that this equation from this for this part, we will ignore the depth of embedment because we are not analyzing the foundation. Okay. Alright, here, okay. So you will have CNC plus half times B times gamma times N gamma. So since we have the C equal to 0, alright, so at the end, to get the Q ultimate, it will be half times with the B times with the gamma and N gamma. So B is the base, the width of the base just now, which is 5.2. Gamma is the unit weight of the soil. Okay, which is 20 kilonewton per meter with the cube. And N gamma here, okay, we refer to the bearing capacity factor. So the angle of friction is 40 for this exercise. So you can get the N gamma is 95.5 here. Okay, so you can get the QF at the end is 4966, the ultimate bearing capacity. Alright, so now we can get the factor of safety against bearing capacity, that 4966 over the Q maximum. So you can get this value, check whether it's adequate or not, fulfill the requirement. If yes, means that the wall is safe due to the bearing capacity. So that's all. Thank you and have a nice day.